Rinaldi e vi do il benvenuto a questo evento organizzato dalla Società Italiana di Parassitologia e vi porto i saluti del nostro presidente, il professore Fabrizio Bruschi, che purtroppo per precedenti impegni accademici non è potuto essere presente a questo evento, ma che dà un forte in bocca al lupo e un abbraccio a tutti voi. Spring Parasitology è un'iniziativa, una delle tante iniziative messe in atto dalla SOIPA. Devo dire che è nata con il precedente consiglio direttivo della SOIPA e l'anima di Spring Parasitology è stata la professoressa Titti Giangaspero, che abbiamo il piacere di avere oggi con noi, davvero. E SOIPA è sempre stata pro giovani. E quindi nel corso di questa emergenza sanitaria, sia il consiglio precedente, il direttivo precedente, di cui faceva parte anche la professoressa Giangaspro e il professore Scala che vedo online, e sia invece il nuovo consiglio direttivo che è stato votato durante l'ultima assemblea
Ciao,
SOIP,
buongiorno a tutti.
hanno sposato davvero con entusiasmo questa brillante idea e questa iniziativa della professoressa Giangaspero di dare proprio voce ai giovani, non soltanto per presentare le loro ricerche, ma anche dal punto di vista logistico e organizzativo. Devo dire che io e la professoressa Giangaspero abbiamo fatto un po' da mamme patrocinando l'evento, ma poi è stato autonomamente gestito dalle dottoresse Morgoglione e Alessandra Barlam, che si sono poi interfacciate con tutti i dottorandi che hanno sposato questa iniziativa. Quindi io do un forte in bocca al lupo ai ragazzi, sono emozionata prima io, quindi figuriamoci loro che dovranno presentare, e davvero plaudo a questa iniziativa e do la parola alla mia amica Titti Giangaspero.
Grazie Laura. Allora, carissimi, davvero solo una piccola riflessione perché un po' ci tocca, appunto, come dice Laura, siamo un po' quelle che abbiamo sostenuto questa iniziativa. Ma com'è nata? Diciamo, in quel momento in cui c'era un turbinio di incontri telematici in pieno Covid, no? E poi la decisione che il nostro congresso non poteva più tenersi. Questa idea di Laura e mia di programmare questa serie di eventi ci è sembrata bellissima. Vabbè, voi potreste dire che è così un atteggiamento un po' autoreferenziale, insomma, un moto di hubris, no? Ma vi assicuro, la soddisfazione di vedere che una idea ha poi preso forma. Credo che voi ce la dobbiate riconoscere e questo è bello. Ma la cosa più entusiasmante di tutto questo è stato come vedere, come dire, l'entusiasmo di cogliere l'entusiasmo di Alessandra e di Maria Elena nel raccogliere l'invito a concretizzare questa idea che era anche abbastanza, come dire, embrionale. Quindi oggi che siamo qua, che cosa possiamo dire? Che la formula questa che avevamo individuato di autogestione ha funzionato, cioè avrete poi contribuito a creare questo momento, diciamo, di condivisione, di confronto di esperienze, di crescita fra di voi, che era esattamente quello che noi intendevamo, no? E, guardate, questo è solo merito vostro, perché è facile avere delle idee e poi bisogna apprezzare, come dire, applicarle. Dalla diapositiva che avete mostrato qui nella cosa, vedo che i temi sono tutti assai interessanti, no? Che aprono sicuramente orizzonti magari, diciamo, meno battuti da qualcuno di voi. Ecco, scusatemi questa, come dire, un tocco di anzianità, ecco, perché tra l'altro siamo proprio, cioè io sono proprio anziana, quindi. Il consiglio che vi diamo in questa vostra fase di formazione è di non rimanere attaccati allo specifico tema che avete affrontato nel corso del dottorato, perché ci sarà tempo per lo specialismo. Lo sapete che adesso si va sempre di più verso lo specialismo, ma
C'è la
avrete tempo.
Titti.
Sì?
Ti salutavo.
Ah,
Ti
ciao Laura,
sostengo.
ciao.
Ciao, buon lavoro a tutti.
Grazie.
Grazie, sì, a loro. Dunque, quindi guardate quanti temi diversi uno dall'altro. Ebbene, veramente mi sento di dire, apritevi la mente, vedrete che ogni tema, anche se vi sembrerà lontano dal vostro che state diciamo affrontando, vi assicuro che presenterà dei lati di trasversalità che neanche vi immaginate, saranno anche delle occasioni per voi di collaborazione, fidatevi, perché un po' ci siamo passati. Quindi con questo, con questa così riflessione, se volete banale, ma insomma era veramente di condivisione, ripasso la parola ad Alessandra Barlam, che oggi è il vostro chairperson, e lasciatemi dire, a nome di tutti i tutor, co-tutor di dottorato che appunto vedo anche presenti, grazie davvero per le soddisfazioni che ci date ogni giorno, è un piacere seguirvi, e che dirvi, buon lavoro, davvero, grazie.
Grazie. Grazie mille.
Bene, allora iniziamo, buonasera, grazie a tutti per essere venuti e benvenuti alla prima sessione di Spring Parasitology. Io non rubo altro tempo all'evento, anche perché la professoressa Rinaldi e Gian Gaspero sono state chiarissime. Volevo fare solo una riflessione, cioè non abbiamo ancora cominciato, ma penso che sia già stato bello, ci siamo conosciuti nonostante il Covid, non ci siamo mai visti di persona, alla fine abbiamo fatto tante nuove conoscenze, sicuramente approfondiremo, magari avremo dei successori, perché noi siamo addirittura d'arrivo, molti di noi, che vorranno continuare, magari diventerà un evento live, chi lo sa, però si può ipotizzare qualcosa del genere. Volevo naturalmente ringraziare la professoressa Gian Gaspero e Rinaldi per aver proposto questa iniziativa e per averci guidato in questo percorso e insomma alla fine per averci portato fin qui alla realizzazione di questo obiettivo. Volevo ringraziare anche Maria Elena per aver condiviso l'organizzazione di questo evento, che è stato molto piacevole, però sappiamo anche un po' impegnativo a tratti. E poi ci tenevo a ringraziare tutti coloro che hanno partecipato, perché mi rendo conto che quest'anno, in particolare con la pausa Covid, eccetera, abbiamo tutti tante attività, magari siamo un po' indietro, quindi mi rendo conto che è un effort quello di partecipare, quindi vi ringrazio per aver partecipato. Detto questo, penso che possiamo iniziare. Volevo fare solo una precisazione, vedo che tutti i microfoni sono già chiusi e i video sono disattivati, io penso che comunque i relatori della giornata possano lasciare anche il video in modalità on, vabbè, valutate voi. A questo punto possiamo iniziare, però come avevamo deciso tutti insieme, io da questo momento passerei alla lingua inglese, anche perché abbiamo alcuni partecipanti che sono stranieri, quindi per correttezza abbiamo deciso di parlare in inglese durante l'evento e di presentare in inglese, giusto?
Sì, yes.
Perfetto. So I'm going to present the first speaker of the day, which is Maria Elena Morgoglione. She is a third year PhD student from the University of Naples Federico II, and she will present her project on intestinal protozoa in buffalo farms, epidemiology and new control strategies. Thank you, Elena. We are ready when you are.
Okay. Just few seconds to share my presentation. Okay. Can you hear me? Can you watch the presentation? Alessandra?
Yes, Elena, yes, right.
Okay, good afternoon to all, and I'm pleased to start the seminar session. As Alessandra said, my project is about intestinal protozoa in buffalo farms, epidemiology and new control strategies. My PhD is innovative industrial PhD program, and the title is OzoPAR, ozonated water for the control of parasites in buffalo farms. I'm going to present my project through a few points, background, aims, protozoa investigated, Emeria SPP and Giardia duodenalis, new control strategies in vitro tests, discussion and conclusion. Water buffaloes are important in the economy of several countries, including Italy. In Italy, the main area where mozzarella cheese is a product is central and southern Italy, where the modern intensive water buffalo breeding has almost completely replaced the traditional extensive buffalo farming. In the modern intensive water buffalo, the protozoa infection are very widespread comparison to helminths, and protozoa infection are important because have negative impacts on animal health, welfare, and production, resulting in huge economic losses. Indeed, the knowledge of parasitological scenario and development of appropriate control strategies are of extreme importance for buffalo farms. Just a moment, okay. A recent review on about parasitological scenario of buffalo farm in central and southern Italy showed highest prevalence, in particular in protozoa, and with Emeria SPP, with a percentage up to 98, Cryptosporidium palmo with 24%, and Giardia duodenalis with 30%. We know well intestinal protozoa, Emeria SPP and Giardia duodenalis. Emeria SPP, they are very widespread and worldwide spread protozoa. About Emeria SPP is a species-specific protozoa common in ruminants, but there are 12 species common in cattle and buffalo, so it's important to highlight there are biomolecular studies in progress to define the difference between the coccidia of cattle and buffalo. Giardia duodenalis is a worldwide zoonotic protozoa that infect a wide range of mammals, and we well know the pathogenic in livestock and mainly in young animals. Among the drugs used to control Emeria in livestock, the most used drugs are dicloxuril and tortrazuril, and their efficacy was demonstrated in previous study conducted by our research group. Instead, there are several works that demonstrate the efficacy of fenbendazole and albendazole to control giardia in buffalo. So the aims of my project were to study the epidemiology of Emeria and giardia in water buffalo farms in southern Italy, to find an alternative and eco-friendly method to control protozoa in water buffalo farms. About Emeria SPP, during my PhD, I collected data about 10-year surveillance of Emeria SPP in cattle and buffalo in a Mediterranean area, where the prevalence was high in both cattle and buffalo. In cattle were below 89%, in buffalo farms was below 8%. The age categories that showed the high prevalence was young animals. Another important point of this study was identification of species presented in this area. We found different species in cattle and buffalo, but it's important to underline the presence of the most pathogenic species common in cattle and buffalo, such as Emeria zwirni, Emeria bovis, Emeria burnensis, and Emeria barili, that species specific for buffalo. Giardia duodenalis is we know well the effect mainly on the young animals, and cross sectional survey conducted in central and southern Italy showed a prevalence up to 30% in buffalo farms in Campania and Lazio region. So it's important to develop new control strategy using alternative approach. Ozone is one of these. Ozone is an allotropic form of oxygen, colorless gas with an acrid odor. It is formed by three oxygen atoms. Ozone is the most powerful oxidizing agent known, and will react with any oxidable molecule. Since its discovery in 1840, the ozone showed its properties to inactivate bacteria, viruses, fungi, yeast, and protozoa. Sorry. And so there are few in literature, there are few studies on the effect of the ozone on protozoa. So the first aim of my project was to standardize and validate a protocol in vitro to inactivate cyst using a different concentration of ozone in water. So we performed in vitro tests on Emeria and Giardia duodenalis using an ozone generator prototype provided by our industrial partner, where I spend a part of my PhD in England. In vitro test on Emeria followed five steps. Resumed starting from fecal sampling, and we obtained seven groups to treat. We used three different ozone concentration, 0.5, 1 and 2 milligram per liter, and we used two time contacts, 5 and 10 minutes, and we had a control group. So after treatment with ozone, we put all the groups in a sporulation, and after 7-8 days we evaluated effect of ozone to inactivate sporulation under microscope. Here are the results. There are not many differences between control group and treated group, but there is a slight reduction in sporulation in groups where we use ozone concentration 1 and 2 milligram per liter, both for two contact times. And here you can see some picture about cyst, sporulated cyst, unsporulated or damaged. This result and this picture could have it seems ozone could have some effect on Emeria sporulation. Regarding about Giardia duodenalis in vitro tests, we followed the four steps, starting from fecal sampling, and in this case we used four ozone concentration, 0.1, 0.3, 0.5 and 1 milligram per liter and two contact time, 1 and 2 minutes. In this case, we used, based on literature, negative control and two positive control with hot water 40 degrees and 80 degrees. After treatment, we evaluated the viability of cyst using a non-fluorogenic dye exclusion method with trypan blue. Here are the results. So the best percentage of not viable cyst was 96.3, and recording in the group where we used ozone concentration 0.5 and 2 minute contacts. So this result seems that ozone with Giardia works better than Emeria. And here you can see some picture about the stained or unstained cyst, because the trypan blue is a dye exclusion, that means colored the non-viable cysts. The second aim was to evaluate the efficacy of ozone in vivo for the treatment and the control of Emeria and Giardia duodenalis in buffaloes. So in vivo tests were planned on Emeria and Giardia duodenalis using the same ozone generator in calves. The in vivo test is in progress, so we are at first step, selected water buffalo farms, total of 5, with the natural infection by Emeria and Giardia. The second step is the coprological screening and animal selection for a total of 60 animals, divided homogeneous groups based on oocyst cyst counts, age, sex and body weight. Once selected the animals, we divided in 4 groups. One group with treated with ozone, with 50 animals, negative control group untreated, and 2 positive control group using toltrazuril for Emeria and fenbendazole for Giardia. So all these results highlight that the intestinal protozoa are still the most common parasites in water buffalo farms. Ozone is a promising alternative to control infection by Emeria and Giardia, but further in vitro and in vivo tests are needed. And moreover, recent studies have highlighted the complex network of interaction occurring between protozoa and the gut commensal flora, showing the potential contribution of the intestinal microbiota in the control of parasitic infection. So I say thanks to SOIPA Society, in particular Professor Gian Gasper and Professor Rinaldi that give us this opportunity. I would like to thank Professor Kringoli, my tutor and my guide in this PhD, and I would thank also Professor Maurelli, Dr. Bosco and all staff of Cremopar that support me in all phase of my work. Thank you for attention.
Grazie. Thank you, Elena. It was a very interesting presentation and a very interesting project. So congratulations.
Thank you.
Well, let's open the discussion. Let's see if there are any questions from the audience or curiosities or comments. I can hear something.
Oh.
Buonasera.
Salve, prof.
Okay. No,
okay.
Se il professore voleva
dire, I think no. I think no.
No, forse voleva solo salutare.
Ok.
Yes,
I know very well your project, of course. I'm with you. Yes, but what are, according to you, the potentiality of using in practice this ozone machine for protozoa infection?
Sorry, can you repeat?
The potentiality.
Ozone is an alternative approach to control protozoa in buffalo farm, but in a different field. In this case, I'm using a novel technique provided by partner, and is less expensive compared to the other product present on the market. I think there will be benefit in general on not only to control parasites or to sanitize the water. I refer mainly to Giardia, because there are a few studies about water treatment to control Giardia using ozone. And is ecological, is important, is eco-friendly, because ozone normally is created by using electric discharges, and in water in particular, when all the organic matter or the minerals present in the water are consumed, the ozone come back in its origin form of oxygen, starting from molecule of water, and so there are any residues in the water. So I think is new frontiers to substitute or to integrate in the daily management of farms to control protozoa and reducing the using of chemical drugs, connecting to the global attention against the antimicrobial resistance. So I think do I satisfy your question, Laura? Yeah. Thank you.
Can I say something? No, it's not yes. Really a question, it's just a comment. No, I wanted to say that like Professor Gian Gaspero was saying before, even though we work on different things, sometimes the application can be common. So like you talked about protozoans, and we focus on protozoans contaminating the foodstuff, so it's a different situation, but still. And I just wanted to say that ozone treatment is also a new frontier in the food industry, because some people are looking at it for like inactivation of protozoan stages in vegetables and stuff like that, as well as UV. But I mean, it's a new approach that they are considering in the food industry as well. So I think it's a very modern topic.
Yes, because, yes, Alessandra, you're right, because in food industry, I refer also to fish industry, there are some company that use ozone to treat fish, the food, to reduce the bacterial elements present on the surface of fish, for example, or in other kind of food. Yes, there are some application in food industries, not only for human destination, but also for zootechnical destination.
Brilliant. So if we don't have any more questions or comments, I would move on to the next speaker. Yes. Okay. Thank you, Elena.
Thank you to all.
Okay, so the next speaker is Georgia Dessy. She is a third year PhD student at the University of Sassari. And she will present her project called Hepatic Parasitosis in Small Ruminants, Epidemiological and Diagnostic Updates. Thank you, Georgia.
Good afternoon to everyone. Among the hepatic parasitosis in sheep of Sardinia, I will discuss two works containing the microcephaly and the
Elena, sorry to interrupt you, but I have the... okay, no, the problem solved. I think one microphone was on. Keep going.
Okay.
There you go.
Sardinia hosts 45% of the Italian sheep stock. This high concentration of animals and the insularity make the island as a unique geographic area for epidemiological studies on parasites. Previous studies carried out in Sardinia have shown that dicrocelliosis is an endemic parasitosis, but most of the data are not recent. Therefore, this study aims to provide new knowledge about the epidemiology of Dicrocelium in sheep farms of Sardinia through coprological analysis, anatomopathological examination of the liver, followed by biomolecular analysis. For the coprom-microscopic survey, a total of 190 sheep farms located in different municipalities in Sardinia were investigated, and within each flock, 15 individual samples were collected. These samples were then split in three pools from five animals older than 3 years of age and analyzed using the flotac method. Data were processed considering the eggs per gram mean of the three fecal pools and were stratified in the four provinces of Sardinia, Cagliari, Sassari, Oristano and Nuoro. Farms were then grouped in four classes considering the EPG mean values. For epidemiological survey, 770 Sardinian sheep slaughtered in Sardinia were submitted to anatomopathological examination to detect the liver parasites and to evaluate the typical terminal thickness bile ducts lesions. For this purpose, seven hepatic areas were selected. In particular, the right and the left lobe of the both visceral face and the diaphragmatic face, quadrate and caudate lobe, and finally the capsule face. For each area, the severity and extension of the lesions indicative of terminal thickness by duct pattern were scored from 0 to 5, where 0 corresponded to absence of lesions and 5 to the maximum extension. In order to identify and count the adult parasites, an incision of the gallbladder was performed and the entire liver parenchyma was cut into slices of 0.5-1 cm. The parasitic burden was classified into 5 classes based on the number of parasites found in the organ. 5 adult dicrocelium were taken from each liver in order to confirm the species based on the morphological keys previously reported, and for the genetic analysis, DNA from 15 adults representing all 4 provinces of the Sardinia were amplified by PCR for the regions ETS2 and then sequenced. 51.1% of farms were coprologically positive for Dicrocelium. The prevalence of Dicroceliosis was significantly lower in the summer compared to the winter, when the odds ratio were 4 times higher than in other seasons. In Spain, it's been reported that mountainous pastures located over 600 meters and with temperatures under 12 degrees represent a higher risk of infection with Dicrocelium. The Copromo microscopic survey showed that the widespread presence of Dicrocelium in Sardinia, but its distribution does not appear homogeneous across the island. In particular, the highest prevalence was found in the province of Nuoro, and the reason could be the same of the winter. Indeed, Nuoro is characterized by the highest altitude and the lowest temperature compared with other provinces. These findings suggest that in some geographical areas, and especially during the winter, it is important to monitor the Crocelium in sheep. Terminal thickened bile ducts on the surface were reported in 40.1% of the examined livers, while on the cut surface was recorded the prevalence of 15.3%. The hepatic areas most involved were the right lobe of the visceral face and the caudate lobe. The terminal thickened bile ducts were not observed in the quadrate lobe, and the score values were higher in the right lobe of the visceral face than the other hepatic localization. There was a moderate to good correlation between the parasite burden and the scores for the severity and extension of the terminal thickened bile duct in the right lobe of the visceral face. The anatomo histopathological examination of the liver showed the Dicrocelium prevalence of 25.5%, 54.1% of which harbored less than 50 adult parasites per organ, while only the 3% harbored over 1,000 parasites. Using the morphological examination, all the Dicrocelium were identified as Dicrocelium detriticum. Regarding the genetical analysis, no intraspecific variation were observed for the TSU gene sequencing, and the sequences from the isolates showed an homology of 99% with the Iranian and Italian isolates. This survey showed the widespread presence of Dicrocelium dendriticum in Sardinia and highlighted the key role of the abattoir and of the coprological analysis in the monitoring of parasitic disease. The inspection at the slaughterhouses can detect the presence of the typical lesion due to Dicrocelium dendriticum in the liver, mostly in the right lobe of the visceral face, and can thus be used to monitor the presence of chronic infection in a given flock. This present work was recently published on the journal Parasites and Vector. Regarding Cysticercus thermicollis, although several attempts have been made for the antemortem diagnosis of cysticercosis by serological test, a final diagnosis of the disease is currently only possible by analyzing the cysticerci and the lesion after slaughtering. Ultrasonography is effective in diagnosing parasitic infections in animals, including other metacystodosis like cystic echinococcosis, but there are no reports describing the ultrasonography findings of Cysticercus thermicollis infection in small ruminants. That in Sardinia, it was reported in labs in 14.6%. Therefore, in this study,
c'è una voce in fondo, chiudete il microfono.
In this study, we describe clinical manifestation, ultrasonography findings, anatomopathological results, and molecular characterization of lungs affected by acute visceral cysticercosis by tenedartigena. In March 2018, 15 lambs of 4 months from a flock of 100 animals presented various degrees of anorexia, lethargy, weakness, and death. Necroscopy on 3 dead animals revealed acute visceral cysticercosis as the cause of the death. The 12 surviving animals underwent physical and coprological examination as well as hepatic ultrasonography. The ultrasonographic examination were performed by an experienced operator with a portable ultrasound unit equipped with 2 multi-frequency linear and microconvex transducers. The liver was visualized by placing the probe in the cranial right hypochondrium or between the right intercostal spaces. Images in video obtained were acquired and stored for offline review. Based on the ultrasonographic findings, the severity of the infection were classified into severe, moderate, and mild. Severe when the lesions affected the whole hepatic parenchyma, moderate when the lesions occupied most of the parenchyma, and mild when the extent of the injuries was less than the normal parenchyma. The appearance of the liver surface and the edge were also examined. During the ultrasonographic examination, B-line of the diaphragmatic surface of the right lung were also observed, along with the free abdominal fluid. The animals that died within 24 hours of the ultrasound scan underwent a necroscopy. Liver and lung parenchymal samples were submitted to histopathological examination and morphological and molecular identification were performed to confirm the diagnosis. On physical examination, lumps showed mostly pale mucous membranes, body condition score less than 3, and finally depression and unwillingness to move. Coprological examination showed the presence of gastrointestinal strongyles and hematodilus X and cyst of hemeria. The infestation was graded as severe in 50%, moderate in 41.6%, and mild in 8.3%. The hepatic lesions were characterized by heterogeneous texture and mixed echogenicity, probably due to the different stage of histological evolution of the hemorrhagic tract caused by Cysticercus tenicolis migration. Injured areas were crossed by several irregular hypoanechoic tracts, 1-2 cm in length and 1-3 mm in width. Infected animals with severe infestation presented two types of cystic structures localized in the hepatic surface and characterized by a thick and hyperechoic wall containing a hyperechoic mural branching component surrounded by anechoic fluid. Two of them also presented intraparenchymal cyst containing a point-like hyperechoic structure surrounded by anechoic fluid. A Doppler color examination confirmed the cystic nature of these structures. All the lumps with the severe infestation presented a rounded liver margin and an irregular thickened hyperechoic liver surface. All the lumps with the mild infestation showed B lines on the diaphragmatic surface of the right lung. The 60% of the lumps with moderate infestation presented rounded liver margins and a large portal lymph nodes. Nobody presented biliary system alterations. Four of the several infected animals died or were euthanized for welfare reasons. Surviving lumps in number of 8 underwent medical treatment with oral praziquantel. Two of them died several days later, however, they were not taken into consideration for the study because too much time had passed since the ultrasound. Six animals survived and were still alive after 2 years. Areas with a non-homogeneous texture within the liver parenchyma cannot be considered specific finding of Cysticercus tenicolis infection. However, it can be distinguished from other hepatic parasitosis, like for example acute fasciolosis, in which the cystic structures are absent. Furthermore, the hepatic parenchymal injury is not associated with alteration in the biliary system. typical of chronic fasciolosis. The crocellosis may reduce the specificity of test, but the operator's experience allows to differentiate the lesions. Instead, the echinococcosis is characterized by larger cystic structures surrounded by normal or moderately heterogeneous parenchyma without evidence of migratory tracts. In addition, due to the animal's young age, would have been too unlikely to misdiagnose among the parasitosis. Gross pathology revealed hepatomegaly perihepatitis with whitish yellow fibrin deposition in the surface, or the animal presented free fluid in the abdomen in which parasitic cysts were floating. The hepatic surface as well as the parenchyma section were crossed by multiple hemorrhagic wavy tracts of 2-3 millimeters in wide. Upon histological examination, the larval tracts appeared to be filled with erythrocytes, neutrophils, eosinophils, necrotic cells debris and fibrin. Migrating cysticerci were surrounded by erythrocytes, neutrophils, eosinophils, necrotic cells, lymphocytes and macrophages. Morphological characteristic of isolated cysts were consistent with those reported in the literature. The morphological identification was confirmed by molecular biology. The present study demonstrates that ultrasonography is a useful diagnostic tool to identify and define the extent and severity of hepatic lesions caused by Cysticercus tenuicolis migration in lumps intravitam. Early diagnosis of cysticercosis in live animals is important from an epidemiological point of view because positive animals indicate that the level of environmental contamination with other metacestodosis. In addition, cysticercosis is not only an economic problem for farmers and the meat industry, but could be also life-threatening for young animals. Therefore, hepatic ultrasonography could be a useful intravitam test to diagnose Cysticercus tenuicolis infestation in sheep, as currently used in human medicine to diagnose fasciolosis and echinococcosis. Like to thank the team with I have the pleasure for working with Professor Scala, Professor Valcasia, Dr. Claudia Tamponi, Dr. Andrea Corda, Dr. Silvia Carta, Dr. Ciria Coligius. Thanks for the attention.
Thank you, Giorgia, for the interesting presentation. So if you are okay with it, I would open the discussion and see if there are any questions for you or curiosities or comments or anything. Let's give them a minute to process all the information. Well, it looks like you have been extremely clear.
Okay.
Yeah, so unless people are 100% sure, they don't want to say anything or make a comment. No, so it looks like everything was very clear. I thank you very much for your presentation. And I will go on with the next speaker, who is Michela Maestrini. She's a second year PhD student at the University of Pisa, and she will present her project called The First Report of Giardia duodenalis Infection in the Crested Porcupine, Istrix cristata, Linnaeus, 1758.
Okay.
Michela, are you there?
Yeah.
I cannot.
No, you cannot.
Elena, can you see her?
No. This is strange because
Okay. There you are.
Okay,
perfect. So, Michela, you have 15 minutes.
Okay.
And good luck. We are ready when you are.
Thank you, Alessandra. And so, as Alessandra said, this is the first report of Giardia duodenalis infection in the crested porcupine. Crested porcupine is the largest rodent among the Italian fauna, and is a nocturnal and herbivorous mammals that tends to share its settlement with other burrowing mammals, for example, red foxes and badgers. The interesting thing is that Italy is the only European country in which Istrix cristata lives. Crested porcupine can be infected by Giardia. Giardia is a genus of flagellated protozoa, and that infects the small intestinal tract of numerous mammals, including humans. In particular, among rodents, there were identified different Giardia species, like Giardia muris, Giardia microti, Giardia cricetidarum, but also three different assemblages of Giardia duodenalis, that are the rodent-specific assemblage G, and other two Giardia duodenalis assemblages, that are the A and B, that are considered potentially zoonotic. So the aim of our study was to perform a parasitological investigation aimed to evaluate the presence of Giardia and other endoparasites and fecal sample of a population of Istrix cristata in central Italy. So the study area was concentrated in the province of Pisa, and the samples were collected during the autumn-winter season of the 2018-2019, and fecal samples were in particular collected from captured animals, road-killed animals, or directly from the soils of feeding areas and pathways. Parasitological and immunological analyses were also performed. In particular, fecal samples that were 52 were examined by commercial rapid immunoassay for the search of coproantigens of Cryptosporidium and Giardia. And for the identification of helminth eggs and protozoan cysts or oocysts, all fecal samples were analyzed by using the mini-flotac technique. Molecular analyses were also performed, and DNA was extracted from Giardia positive samples. And so the isolates were subjected to nested PCR at the SSU ribosomal RNA locus to assign every isolate to an species of Giardia and to an assemblage. For the subassemblage, the TPI locus amplification was performed. So these are our results, and as you can see, at the immunoassay, 25 out of 52 samples were found Giardia positive, while only one sample were found Cryptosporidium positive. At the mini-flotac technique, 39 out of 52 samples were found positive for at least one taxa of parasites, and in particular we identified eggs of Trichuris, gastrointestinal strongyle, and capillary eggs, and in only one sample was identified a coccidian oocyst. Moreover, 20 out of 39 samples were found positive for a multiple parasite infection. These are the results of molecular analysis, and a preliminary analysis was performed on 17 out of 52 sample Giardia positive samples. So expected bands were achieved for 12 out of 17 isolates, and all the isolates were assigned to Giardia dodenalis species and to assemblage B. But only for 3 out of 70 samples, the amplification of the TPI locus was successfully. Of these three samples, one was assigned to the subassemblage B4, while the other two were assigned to the subassemblage A2. Attempts to further subtype samples at the TPI locus were not successful. So, in conclusion, we can affirm that this is the first report of Giardia dodenalis in Hystrix cristata. And the identification of the potential zoonotic assemblages that are the A and B can suggest the potential role of crested porcupine as a reservoir of zoonotic genotypes of Giardia dodenalis. Moreover, as observed in other wild rodent species, the result here obtained revealed an high Giardia infection rate, and the eventual circulation and transmission of this potentially zoonotic genotype among the population of crested porcupine, red foxes, badgers, and wild boar need to be further evaluated. Concerning the other identified parasites, this study is also the first report of a coccidian and a cryptosporidium infection in the crested porcupine. And in particular about the cryptosporidium, it will be extremely interesting to perform molecular analysis for the identification of the cryptosporidium species involved in the infection and for evaluate its potential zoonotic. So in conclusion, more studies are needed on the epidemiology of Giardia and other underparasite species identified the crested porcupine population in examined areas. So I want to say thanks to Francesca Coppola, Federica Berilli, Isabel Guadano Procesi, Antonio Felicioli, and my professor tutor Stefania Perrucci, which have collaborated with us for the realization of this study. And thank you for your attention.
Thank you, Michela.
Thank you.
Very nice presentation.
Yeah, I'm sorry because it's a shorter presentation in comparison. No,
it's way better when they are shorter than too long. So I think everyone is doing great today. We'll see what Barbara is going to do. No, but so far everyone went well. I'm going to open the discussion and I'm going to ask if there are any questions. I have a couple of them, but they are mostly curiosity. I saved all of them for you.
Okay.
So
thank you.
Does anyone have any questions for Michela?
Yes, if I can, me. I'm Michele also.
Oh, hi. Thank you.
Hi. Thanks, and really nice information, especially for my practice, because I work with rodents and Hystrix. I would ask to you if you have any experience in animals that are kept in captivity about Giardia in Hystrix.
No, in captivity, no, only in nature. And my colleague have captured this animal, but they are a part of a wild population and very anthropic zone, because the study area was very near to a little city, but they are totally wild. So I'm sorry, but no. Thank you for asking.
Okay. Have you interest in continuous this type of work, or do you finish it about this?
Yeah, this is a work in which I had collaborate, but it's not the topic of my PhD thesis. It is extremely different, but there is another PhD student that is at the first year, that is Isabel Guadano, that is the PhD student of Professor Federica Berrilli, that deal a lot with this topic. So I suggest you to contact her, because I'm very interested in this topic, but it's not my PhD thesis in particular.
Okay. Thanks. We will keep in touch. Thanks so much.
Yeah, of course. Thank you.
Alessandra, posso fare una precisazione?
Certo, prego.
Michele, ciao, sono Federica Berrilli. Solo per dirti, buongiorno Michela, complimenti.
Buongiorno.
No, solo per quanto riguarda la prima domanda che hai fatto, non mi ricordo se hai, cioè riguardo il fatto di avere altri esemplari in captive, non selvatici, sì. Però ci sono in realtà, noi stiamo facendo dei lavori, ma non su Giardia, su Tricuris, da istrici che sono stati tenuti in cattività. Poi se vuoi su questa cosa ci possiamo sentire privatamente, ecco tutto qua.
Ok, volentieri, grazie.
Sì, grazie. Io chiedevo questo perché, diciamo, lavoro con gli istrici, però nati in cattività nei giardini zoologici, quindi era molto interessante, perché spesso abbiamo la giardia negli zoo e stata che quello europeo e africano. In genere negli zoo c'è quello asiatico, però è assolutamente sovrapponibile tassonomicamente, quindi sarebbe interessante magari campionare gli animali nei centri di recupero o negli zoo. Grazie, poi ci teniamo in contatto. Grazie mille.
Assolutamente, grazie.
There is a paper, a report about the Giardia and other parasites that is not very deeply accurate in the molecular analysis, but analyze a lot of parasites in the Istrix indica. And not in the Strix cristata. And I don't know, I imagine that you know this work, but it's of Chakraborty and other authors that I don't remember right now. But if you want, I can send you the work.
Okay. Thank you.
You're welcome.
Well, this is a very active discussion. I just wanted to ask you something. I don't know whether I missed it or I didn't catch it. I was just wondering, did you say that all the samples that you tested molecularly were assemblage B? Is that correct?
Yeah. This is a very nice question. All the assemblages were B. But after the amplification of the TPI locus, we were found two of the three samples that were successfully amplified at the TPI locus.
Okay.
Resulted one subassemblage B4 and the other two subassemblage A2. So you are right, there is a discordance between the assemblage that is B for all and the subassemblages.
Okay, perfect.
This is a quite common thing in Giardia duodenalis. And this may be caused by different causes that are, for example, mixed infection. For example, an animal have a Giardia infection of different assemblages or subassemblages, or there is also a very high heterogeneity in the allelic sequences. So you can find the assemblage B, but the sub-assemblage is the A. And
No, but anyway, as you said in your conclusions, I find it really interesting because they are both zoonotic assemblages. And as you said, the sampling was done in the old Wild West. It was like close to a town or something. So I think it's very relevant.
Yeah. And it will be interesting to understand if crested porcupine can be a reservoir of, or if they catch the infection from humans, or by other wild mammals like red foxes and badgers, because they live in the same settlement and they share the same environment, so it may be really easy contamination among the different population of wild animals.
Yeah, definitely. Keep us posted on what happens, because next year you will be a third year PhD, so you will be here again. So
of course. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Thank you to all.
So let's jump to the next and the last speaker of the first session of Spring Parasitology. So welcome, Barbara. The first speaker is Barbara Moroni, a second year PhD student at the University of Torino. And today she will present her project, which is called Sarcoptes scabiei in European Wildlife, Solving the Epidemiological Enigma and Exploring Control Options. Thank you, Barbara.
Thank you, Alessandra. So for the next 15 minutes, I'm going to talk about my PhD project, which is under the supervision of Professor Luca Rossi. Can you hear me? Yes.
Yes, okay. Absolutely.
Okay.
Everything is fine.
And it is about the epidemiological and control aspects of Sarcoptes mange in wildlife. So as you all know, Sarcoptes scabiei is an arthropod belonging to the family Sarcoptidae, and it is the causative agent of Sarcoptes mange, also known as scabies in humans. And compared to other micro and macro parasites, it can affect an incredibly broad host range of more than 100 mammal species worldwide. However, in the scientific community, there has been an ongoing and open debate in the last decades on the spreading patterns and the host specificity of the different Sarcoptes mange strains. And many genetic studies attempted to prove the Sarcoptes mange diversities with the help of molecular markers, such as the ETS2 or the COX1 gene. Unfortunately, they failed to prove any kind of diversities or specificity of Sarcoptes mange strains. And finally, macrosatellites were used as molecular markers in recent genetic studies, revealing the existence of different spreading patterns, especially in wildlife, such as the prey-to-predator spreading patterns revealed between cheetahs and Thompson gazelle in Kenya, or the host taxon-derived spreading pattern in European wildlife that revealed the existence of three main Sarcoptes strains, the carnivore, the herbivore, and the omnivore one. So as a matter of fact, macrosatellites opened the door for the characterization of Sarcoptes mange strains, and especially in wildlife. But why is Sarcoptes mange so important in wildlife? Because it can trigger a chain reaction mechanism starting with intense itch and scratching, leading to secondary bacterial infections as well as chronic skin lesions. This will generate heat dispersion as well as an increased metabolism demand. So the animal will then start to isolate and reduce his foraging time till the starving and ultimately to the death. So Sarcoptes mange can lead to the collapse of entire wildlife populations. And therefore, what are the available treatment strategies for wildlife? First of all, we should specify that not always for wildlife, the treatment is necessary. As the main outcome of a severe outbreak in wildlife might be this natural selection of resistant individuals, which is a desirable effect. However, in highly susceptible species, or in endangered species, the human intervention is always desirable and considerable. So according to this systematic review, the ivermectin treatment is the ivermectin drug is the most common and effective drug used in captive and free-ranging wildlife at a dose range between 200 to 400 micrograms per kilo subcutaneously or by remote rifle darting. However, treating individual animals is an expensive procedure, and therefore it is mainly applicable for endangered species in conservation, for conservation purposes, or for zoo animal in captivity. On the other hand, there are also highly abundant species that are highly susceptible to sarcoptin mange and that are game animal species, so hunted species, such as the Alpine chamois in Italy or the Iberian ibex in Spain. And in these species, obviously, the individual treatment is not sustainable nor available. And therefore, new treatment should be explored with the help of experimental field. So the main objectives of my PhD are to fine-tune the circulating strains of sarcoptin mange in wildlife through a genetic study using microsatellites as molecular markers, and to explore new control strategies in the targeted species that we chose, so the Iberian ibex in Spain, through a pharmacokinetic study. So first of all, for my genetic study, I had to collect mite samples from skin scrapings of captured narcotized wildlife or through skin samples of dead wildlife during necropsies. And then I isolated mites through direct stereomicroscope examination, and then I stored them at minus 20 degrees till the DNA extraction, which was performed without a specific kit, but with the use of a validated method called the hot shot plus thermal shock technique. Then I performed a multiplex PCR using 10 specific primers for Sarcoptes cabiae. And then the macrosatellite analysis was performed with a genetic analyzer. But what are these macrosatellites? Macrosatellites are short fragments of non-coding DNA consisting in 1 to 6 base repeated base pair with a high mutation rate between different individuals of the same species. So this is why they are considered good molecular markers and very good for population genetics analysis, as well as in DNA profiling and in forensic analysis. So coming back to my PhD, in the last 2 years, I collected and processed 170 mites from 10 species, but this was just a little implementation of a large database of almost 20 years of collection with more than 1,100 Sarcoptes mites from 40 mammal species, especially foxes, chamois, and other herbivores, as you can see. And as you can see from this world map, showing the location and the origin of the samples of our database in Turin, they are mainly from Europe and mainly from Italy and Spain. So this is why my first analysis happened to be in Spain about wild herbivores affected by sarcoptin mange. And our main goal was to understand how many strains are currently of sarcoptin mange are currently circulating in Spain, and which are the correlations between between the sarcoptin mange strain and the host species and or the geographical location. So in Spain, the first outbreak of sarcoptin mange has occurred in 1987 in the local population of Iberian ibexes in the Sierra de Cazorla Natural Park. And it killed nearly 95% of this naive population in less than 4 years. And since then, sarcoptin mange has spread all over the Iberian Peninsula. However, the origin and the persistence of this ectoparasite in Spain remains still unclear. So in this analysis, I included 121 animals from 11 different sampling sites, as you can see. The main outcome of this analysis showed that currently 3 main strains of sarcoptin mange are circulating in wild herbivores in Spain. As you can see from this PCN analysis, they are very well separated, genetically separated clusters of mites, and they are both geographically related and host related. As you can see, the red cluster represents only mites from red deer from the north of Spain, while the green cluster represents only mites from Iberian ibexes from the south of Spain, while the blue cluster very interestingly represents mites from different, very separated and different areas in Spain from different host species. So all the six host species that I included in my study are represented in this cluster. So this means that only one genetic cluster of Sarcoptin mange might affect different species in different animals. And our main conclusion was that a domestic animal, and most probably an infected goat, was the original cause of the original outbreaks in Spain affecting wild herbivores. So a paper is going to be submitted soon about this analysis. The second main analysis of my PhD project about the genetic study is about wild boar. So wild boars are not famous hosts for Sarcoptin mange, at least in Spain. This is why no outbreaks were reported of Sarcoptin mange were reported in the scientific literature. However, serological surveys recently published, they reveal the presence of antibodies in wild boars that didn't present any clinical sign. So interestingly, three outbreaks were reported in the last year from wildlife authorities in Spain, and they sent us mite samples. So our main goal was to understand the origin of these three outbreaks in three different areas in Spain. And to do that, we compared mites from wild boars with mites from the only other species that is currently affected by Sarcoptin mange in the same areas, which is the Iberian ibex, as always. So the main result of this analysis was that one wild boar was unambiguously affected by Sarcoptin mange from an Iberian ibex that was in the same area, of course. As the mite from this wild boar has exactly the same genetic profile of mites from the Iberian ibex. While the other two wild boars from the south of Spain, they had a wild boar specific strain of Sarcoptin mange, as you can see from this graphic. So the genetic profile of the mites were completely different. So, and this is even more clear with this phylogenetic tree that I elaborated. And as you can see, the wild boar on the right is very close to the other Iberian ibexes on the right, while the other two wild boars are clearly separated. So the main conclusion of this study was that transmission between Iberian ibex and wild boar is of Sarcoptin mange, of course, is clearly possible, although it has never been described before. And a paper describing this analysis is going to submit it soon as well. So moving to the second objective of my PhD, this is about the treatment strategies in wildlife and especially in highly abundant species in Europe, such as the Iberian ibex. So after a nice collaboration with our Spanish colleagues, a paper came out pointing out the controversies of the treatment of Sarcoptin mange in free-ranging wildlife. So the main strategies that we should adopt are population measure strategies rather than an individual approach on these free-ranging wildlife. So we started with a first step would be to know the pharmacokinetic trial and how efficient is ivermectin treatment administered orally. Why orally? Because it's a user-friendly way of mass treating free-ranging animals. So to do that, we firstly needed to know the pharmacokinetic profile of ivermectin in these animals, in the Iberian ibex. So this is why we started a pharmacokinetic study in collaboration with the University of Barcelona and the Junta de Andalucía in the south of Spain, where nine healthy Iberian ibexes were experimentally orally treated with ivermectin at a dose rate of 500 micrograms per kilo body weight. And then they were blood sampled nine times before and after the treatment up to 45 days. Then the blood samples were centrifuged and sent to our laboratory in Turin, where I performed the solid phase extraction followed by the HPLC analysis with fluorescence detection, so the chromatography. The results of the HPLC analysis are as follows. So the maximum concentration of ivermectin in the plasma of these 9 Iberian ibexes was reached after 24 hours. And incredibly, ivermectin was detectable after 45 days after the treatment. Although only after only 7 days of the treatment, ivermectin reached in almost all the animals a minimum concentration in the plasma. So although we cannot surely say that the oral treatment of ivermectin in Iberian ibex is actually effective, we can surely say that this data will serve as baseline data for further investigation in the field and in affected animals by sarcoptin mange. So I would like to thank all the people who contributed to this project and all the people from my unit, parasitology unit, and all the people who sent us mites from all over the world, and of course professors Laura Rinaldi and Professor Gian Gaspero and Alessandra and Maria Elena, my colleagues, for giving me this opportunity of presenting in this very, very nice webinar. And thank you all for your attention.
Thank you, Barbara.
Sorry if I'm being too long.
Also, very well done. I really like your effects and how the presentation looked like, by the way.
Thank you.
I'm going to open the discussion, so let's see if we have any questions. Do we have any questions? Let's give people a minute. They need to process what's been said. I can hear something.
I can.
Can you hear something? Oh, yes. I am pretty sure that someone is trying to talk.
I'm not sure.
I can see. Like something, and I can hear something, but I don't know, I may be wrong about that. I can see the Luca Rossi page flashing, so it looks like he's trying to talk, but I'm not sure.
Yeah, maybe it's possible.
Anyway, if anyone is having a hard time talking, we have a chat, so maybe you can try and write it down if there is a problem. I don't know. Maybe not. Well, I mean, anyway, if they want to ask you any questions, I'm sure they can get in touch. Ah, no. Io sento. Okay. Well, Barbara, thank you very much for your presentation. It looks like you have been, someone is saying something. Michele says it was a brilliant presentation and very interesting. Congratulations.
Thank you.
Of course, I agree with him. So congratulations to you. And so I think we are done for today with this first session. So we will see each other next week with the second session. Maria Elena is going to be the chair and we will have 3 more presentations. So don't miss it. And thanks everyone for presenting today and for coming. We had a big audience. I think at some point that there were more than 60 people. We really didn't expect something like that to happen.
Yeah, okay. It was nice. Thank really you. Nice. Thank you.
Complimenti, Barbara. Super interessante.
Grazie mille, anche le vostre presentazioni erano molto interessanti.
Quelle di tutti, ovviamente.
Complimenti a tutti. Va bene, allora, okay. La settimana prossima e grazie a tutti per essere venuti.
Grazie,
grazie, grazie a te, Alessandra.
Buona serata. Ciao.
Ciao.
Ciao. Ciao.